Hi, welcome to another Bitcoin video. I think you're going to like this video. We're going to talk about a rather advanced topic about correlation. So we're going to check how are Bitcoin returns correlated to traditional stock market returns. And we will discuss why is this actually important. I've prepared quite a few charts for you. There are some really interesting results. And so without further ado, let's jump right into it. So why does correlation matter at all? So what correlation does is it measures how likely is it that two assets go into the same direction at the same time. So usually within the stock market and within the crypto market, between the different assets, we have quite a high correlation. So that means when we have a good day in crypto land, almost all of the cryptos go up at the same time. So basically when Bitcoin goes up, everything else follows. And the same is true when everything goes down. Once Bitcoin falls, the rest falls as well. And that's basically what's meant by when we say assets have high correlation. So say you have asset 1 in green, it moves something like this. And then we have asset 2 in red, and it moves pretty similar to that. Maybe slightly different, but pretty similar. And so those two assets have now a high correlation. Now the problem with high correlation is when we now combine those two assets into a portfolio, we have a very similar performance line. So say it would look something like this. So in the end, you could have just bought one of the assets and get a very similar return. But what if our assets were not that much correlated? So let's assume the following. So let's say our second asset has a negative correlation to the first asset. That would look something like this. So when asset 1 goes up, asset 2 goes down, and the other way around. Okay. Now if you combine a portfolio out of those two assets, we get something that looks way less volatile. So we get a very steady increase. So when building a portfolio, the idea is you want to get as little correlation or possibly even negative correlation to your existing assets, because then you can reduce the overall portfolio volatility. So that's why correlation matters. If you can achieve to buy assets that increase in value over time, but that are negatively or at least little correlated to each other, you can build a portfolio that has less price risk than the individual components in that portfolio. And so let's move now to the concept. How do we actually measure correlation? The classical textbook example would be, say you have stock A, which would only profit if weather is good. So say you own a tennis club and it only has outdoor tennis courts. And so when weather is good, you make money. When weather is bad, nobody comes. So what you should then do is you try to eliminate the risk of the weather. So you would build outdoor tennis courts. So people would come to your tennis club when it rains. So when you have both outdoor and indoor tennis courts, you eliminate the risk associated with the weather. So no matter if the sun shines or it rains, you will make profits anyways. So now the question is, how can we plot this? How can we display the dependencies, the correlations between two asset returns? We can use a scatter chart like this. So this chart now shows perfect correlation. On one axis, say the x-axis, we have the returns of asset A, and on the y-axis of asset B. So let's say in one day, asset A went up 10%, then asset B on that same day would have also gone up 10%. Well, that's perfect correlation. So on this graph, this would form a perfect line. The slope of this line doesn't matter. So say when asset A would make 5% and asset B would make 2.5, and we would have a steeper slope in this graph. So the returns of both assets in the same time window move in tandem. On this day, asset A made 17% and asset B also made 17%, both positive, both move in the same direction. On another day, asset A loses 5%, asset B loses 5% as well. So that's the case that we don't want to have. We don't want to combine those two assets in a portfolio if possible. Now the perfect case that we do want to have is negative correlation. So say asset A makes 5%, then asset B loses 5%. So the assets move in exactly opposite directions. And so when you have a negative slope here, that's what you actually want. Now these are very extreme examples, right? Positive correlation means we have a coefficient of +1. Negative correlation means we have a coefficient of -1. In practice, we won't see those straight lines. We will see a bit of noise. In practice, we never measure coefficients at exactly 1 or exactly -1. We usually measure something in between. So now let's look at a correlation coefficient of 0. So not minus 1, not plus 1, but 0. And that's how that would look like. So the returns of both assets are completely unrelated from one another. There's no real structure to be seen here. When asset A rises, asset B might go up or down. There's no correlation at all, so the correlation coefficient is 0. Okay, so enough theory now. But still, before I jump into Bitcoin, and before we look at the correlation of Bitcoin to the S&P 500, let's first look at what's the correlation of stocks within the S&P 500 to the overall market. So as an example, I just took Apple, and we're going to look at how much do Apple returns correlate to S&P 500 returns. So in practice, this is how such a return distribution would look like. On the x-axis, we have the weekly returns of Apple, and on the y-axis, the weekly returns of the S&P 500. So this point over here means that at some point in time, in 1 week, Apple returned around 11%, and at the same time, the S&P 500 returned around 6%. That's what this point over here means. So just by eyeballing this chart, we can already see there is a positive correlation between the two assets. Something going on that looks a bit like this. It's obviously not perfectly correlated, but there is a tendency that when one of the assets rises, the other one rises as well. And the same is true for the other direction as well. When one of the assets falls, the other asset falls as well. So what's useful now is to put a regression line through this. And so in green, we see now the regression line. So we do have positive correlation, not perfect, but clearly visible. So in here, we see around 10 years of price history. And we can already see from this graph that we have a positive correlation coefficient over those 10 years. Now, the correlation between two assets might not be stable over time, right? There might be periods when they're highly correlated, say, when there's an external event such as Corona, so everything crashes, and so we have very high correlation. But then there are other times where there are no such events, and correlation stabilizes to some regular value. So the correlation is always a measure tied to a specific time frame. We look at returns within a specific time frame. So in this chart, we look at 10 years. But we can calculate the correlation coefficient, say for only 3 months, and then we just look at the price history and roll this 3-month window over the price history and look, what's the correlation coefficient? How much were returns correlated in the early days and how much were they correlated in the later days? And so when we calculate such a rolling correlation coefficient, we get different charts for different time frames. So let's look at the 3-month rolling correlation coefficient. So we do see quite a lot of fluctuations here. Most of the time, the correlation between Apple returns and the S&P 500 are positive, so they're all above zero. And there are times where correlation is even close to one. We do see quite a lot of fluctuation in the correlation coefficient when we just measure over 3 months. The correlation coefficient can be between plus one and minus one. And say when we mainly hold S&P 500 stocks and we want to add some additional asset to this portfolio, we want the correlation of this new asset to be as close to minus one as possible. Ideally, a negatively correlated asset, an asset that would be not correlated at all, say close to the zero line, would also be fine. What we don't want is an asset that has a correlation coefficient close to one, because then we could have just bought additional S&P 500 shares. We don't need to add another asset into our portfolio. So since the results here are quite volatile, let's expand the time frame beyond those 3 months and see if we get more stable, more reliable results. So this is the 6-month rolling correlation coefficient. This is the 1 year. So here we can already see over 1 year, when we look at weekly returns, we don't have a single 1 year period with a negative correlation coefficient. Here's the 2-year graph and the 4-year graph. So correlation is positive. Correlation is between 0.4 and 0.7. And so adding Apple to your overall S&P 500 index is not going to help much in reducing the overall volatility, the overall price risk of your portfolio. It's also interesting that over time the correlation went up. There are several ways to explain this. One explanation would be that Apple just became a bigger share of the S&P 500. It grew faster than the S&P 500 in those 10 years. And so it's just a bigger part, a bigger fraction of the S&P 500, and so the returns need to be correlated more. The second explanation is that nowadays a lot of people just buy index funds. They don't buy into the individual stocks that much anymore. And this also leads to individual stocks being more correlated to each other because everybody buys just the whole basket. And so the whole basket moves into the same direction. Now let's get into what you actually came for. The correlation between the S&P 500 and Bitcoin. This is a scatter plot of Bitcoin on the x-axis and the S&P 500 on the y-axis. And just by glancing at this, we can't really draw a line that easily that goes into this direction. So we can already see the correlation between Bitcoin and the general stock market is lower. Now I quickly want to explain why I took weekly returns here and not daily returns. Two reasons. First, Bitcoin's markets are open on Saturdays and Sundays, stock markets are not. So the question is, what should we do with those days? Should we just discard the Bitcoin price data on those days? Or should we bake in those returns into, say, the Monday of the S&P 500? So that's one complication. That's why daily returns are a problem. Another problem with daily returns is that the stock market doesn't open 24/7. And so you would take a daily return of the S&P 500 that's open just for several hours and compare this with a completely different time frame of Bitcoin that's 24 hours. And so if you were to take daily returns for this correlation analysis, you would compare returns from completely different time frames. If we, however, take the weekly returns, we don't have that problem. We just look at what was the performance Monday morning to Monday morning, both in Bitcoin and in the S&P 500. And so we have comparable time frames and we get at a more realistic correlation. So let's get back to the scatter plot. Let's draw again a regression line through this. We can see a positive slope. Ideally, we would have had a negative slope. So Bitcoin being negatively correlated with the S&P 500. But generally, just by looking at this, we can already see this line does not represent the underlying data points very well. And so the correlation is probably rather weak. So let's compare this again with the regression line of the S&P 500. So this is Bitcoin. This is the S&P 500. Bitcoin, S&P 500. So in the S&P 500, we can really see this line represents those points way better. We do have a few outliers, but the line really goes right through the middle of this cloud over here. With Bitcoin, those points are way further away from this line. So now let's look at the rolling correlation coefficient for Bitcoin. That's how it looks like. So we see a lot of noise over here. It goes up and down between 1 and minus 60. So taking just 3 months to calculate the correlation coefficient is probably not enough. But let's still compare this with what we got for the S&P 500 versus Apple. So here we got Bitcoin versus S&P 500. Here we got Apple. So already, even though we got that much noise, we can see Apple mainly runs between 0 and 0.8 correlation. Bitcoin, however, hovers around the zero mark. And that's good. We want uncorrelated or negatively correlated assets. Now this is Bitcoin's 6-month rolling correlation. Let's look further at the 1 year, the 2 year, and the 4 year. So I think the 2 year and the 4 year are already pretty good graphs. We can see that it started out pretty close to zero or even negative, but then over time, the correlation slightly increases. We do see over here that correlation shot up, and that's during the Corona crash. So both Bitcoin as well as the S&P 500 crashed around a similar time. And so the correlation of the return of those two assets went up. So let's compare again Bitcoin to Apple. So here, Bitcoin to S&P 500, and here, Apple to S&P 500. So the correlation is way lower for Bitcoin. Both correlations are increasing over time, but still we can see that Bitcoin's correlation to the general stock market is still very low. So what do those graphs tell me? It tells me that as the Bitcoin market matures, prices do tend to move more in tandem with traditional markets. So we do see that Bitcoin returns tend to correlate more with the S&P 500 over time, but we are still pretty far away from how much stocks in general correlate with the overall market. So Bitcoin still has a use case to add to a traditional portfolio in order to reduce overall portfolio volatility. At some point, this might change. So according to this graph, we might be there in, say, 5 to 10 years. So it grew from, say, 0.1 to a correlation of 2. Apple started at 0.4 in this chart. So in 5 to 10 years, we might be at a way higher correlation. But until then, Bitcoin is a good vehicle to use as a diversifier for any traditional portfolio to obviously spice up returns, but even to reduce overall portfolio volatility, reduce overall price risk. So it's interesting, right? You add a rather risky asset to your portfolio, but because it has very little correlation to the rest of your portfolio, your overall portfolio risk actually decreases. You buy something risky, but due to little correlation, your overall risk decreases. If you enjoyed this kind of analysis, feel free to subscribe. I publish 1 to 2 videos a week. If you do have questions about this analysis, or if you would like me to look at some other data, feel free to comment this down below. I will look at every comment, and obviously a like would be appreciated as well. See you next time. Bye.